Welcome to St. Paul's Lutheran. We're grateful that you can join with us today. We do have friendship registries and the black books on the aisle. If you would sign and pass them down, we would appreciate that. And today we are welcoming Pastor Kathy Brown from St. Mary's Lutheran. Thank you. For everything, there is a season. We hear those familiar words telling us that life is full of changes. Jesus' parables are also filled with images of lives transformed. Just as the mustard seed grows into a tree, or yeast turns into flour, into bread, we too are called to be agents of change in the kingdom of God. Christ did not come to earth to maintain the status quo, but rather to usher in a change of season. O God, you are the source of our hope. When we grow weary and faint, when our plans fall to dust, when the world lacks joy and beauty, O God, we praise you for the gift of your Son. Please join us as we sing Jesus, Keep Me Near the Cross, 335 in your book or up on the screen. Please stand as you are able. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
O
God of the ages, your creation resolves through seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night. When the seasons come and go and uncertainty looms ahead, we long for the consistency of your love. Give us courage, wisdom, and patience to be your agents of change in the world. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
You may be seated.
First reading is from Ecclesiastes, the third chapter, beginning with the first verse. For everything there is a season, a time for every activity under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to harvest, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to tear down and a time to build up, a time to cry and a time to laugh, a time to grieve and a time to dance, a time to scatter stones and a time to gather stones, a time to embrace and a time to turn away, a time to search and a time to quit searching, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to mend, a time to be quiet and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please stand for the gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 13th chapter, beginning with the 18th verse. Glory to you, O Lord. Then Jesus said, "What is the kingdom of God like? How can I illustrate it? It is like a tiny mustard seed that a man planted in the garden. It grows and becomes a tree, and the birds make nests in its branches." He also asked, "What else is the kingdom of God like?" "It is like the yeast a woman used in making bread. Even though she put only a little yeast in 3 measures of flour, it permeated every part of the dough." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated.
Mustard seeds. Now you can hear me. Tiny, seemingly lifeless seeds when they're in a spice jar on your shelf. But when planted in the ground and watered and tended, they change into great bushes that offer shelter and food for birds. And in its own time, in its change from sprout to flowering bush to offering up its own seed back to the ground, the mustard plant endures its own change of seasons, just as the birds and the people around it who live there and walk there experience those same changes. They have to deal with whatever nature throws at them and adapt. If you've ever baked bread or any other kind of yeast dough, the tiny little grains of yeast or must from fruit, if you're going from fruit to make sourdough bread from its inception, that yeast or that must grows in between the strands of gluten and the flour, or if you're making gluten-free bread in between the strands of xanthan gum and whatever flour you might be using. And it's that growth that makes the bread to rise, expanding it from a relatively small lump of dough into something that can fill a whole bowl and make many loaves. The texture of the dough changes depending upon the amount of time it's allowed to proof or rise, the number of times you punch it down and permit it to rise again, and even the conditions of the weather on any given day. And that baker has to work with the dough to adapt, to make whatever changes that are needed for a successful bake. The writer of Ecclesiastes addresses myriad changes that come to us in our life journeys on earth. While likely not expected to have been an exhaustive in nature, the list of changes, the different seasons of life, remind us that this life we live is not a static one. We're not meant to just sit still. This life is full of movement and transformation, changes of seasons, birth to death, mourning and dancing, war and peace, and everything else in between. We live through nature's change of seasons, from winter to spring, summer to fall, making the adjustments as we go, almost as matter of fact, without really giving much thought to it.
And I wonder if that's perhaps because we know we don't have any control over the weather, right? Although we still can have and have had influences on climate change. But still on a day-to-day basis, especially if you're living in southeastern Wisconsin, we just take whatever nature gives us, even if it means bundling up with a jacket and mittens in the morning and then putting on shorts in the evening when things turn warmer. We respond to changes in nature with changes in behavior. Changes of seasons in our life seem to pose more of a challenge. We can think of some of those seasons, perhaps going off to college or going to live on your own for the first time, graduations, arrival of a first child or grandchild, enduring a chronic illness, becoming an empty nester at some point, retirement, death of a spouse. All of those are difficult changes of seasons in our lives that pose challenges. And what about change in the church? As easy as the change of nature seasons can seem matter of fact and just a way of life, it seems like in the church we're often very afraid of change. We resist, we fight it. And I wonder why that is. Well, I think we grow comfortable with our traditions, especially if we've grown up in a congregation and stayed there our whole lives. I remember how difficult it was for me to make my decision to go back to leave my career world and go back to school and go into ministry and go to seminary. And I think part of that hesitancy was having to leave my home church, the church where I had been Sunday schooled, confirmed, mentored, was in youth group, taught Sunday school, worshiped, sang in the choir, was a member of women's circles, participated in Bible studies, served on church council, cooked and served banquets and funeral luncheons from the church basement kitchen. It was a big change, leaving that all behind. But I needed to do so to enter into a different season in my life. Perhaps the other reason we don't change so well in church is because we've had such great successes in our past that we want to hang on to that, because we think if we do, we'll regain that success. Or we want to remain in control of how we have always done things, because they were our comfort food of sorts. We want things to stay the same because that's where we found our sense of self, our sense of authority, our sense of belonging, like I did at my home church. It's not that any of those things are bad, but we're not meant to be static. Go back to those words of Ecclesiastes, to everything, there is a time and season under heaven, whether we like it or not. I'd like to share with you Father Richard Rohr's devotion from February 20th of this year. In this that I received from the Center for Action and Contemplation. In this excerpt from his 1980s talk, The Four Gospels, Father Richard reflects on what it means to follow Jesus. Immediately after the temptation in the desert, Jesus goes out to Galilee and there he begins to preach. His initial preaching is summed up in the verse, "Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand." It is a theologically packed statement. What does the word repent mean? First of all, it doesn't mean to beat ourselves up or feel bad about ourselves. Repent, or metanoia in Greek, means to turn around, to change. The first word that comes out of Jesus' mouth is change. Be willing to change. People who are not willing to change are not willing to turn away from themselves. What we're in love with is usually not God. We're in love with our way of thinking, our way of explaining, our way of doing. One of the greatest ways to protect ourselves from God and to protect ourselves from truth and grace is simply to buy into some kind of cheap conventionalism and call it tradition. But the great traditions always call people on a journey of faith to keep changing. There's no other way this human personality can open up to all that God is asking of us. There's no way we can open up to all we have to learn, all we have to experience, unless we're willing to let go of the idols of yesterday and the idols of today. The best protection from the next word of God is the last word of God. We take what we heard from God last year and we build a whole system around it, and then we sit there for the rest of our lives. Immediately after he begins his preaching, Jesus calls his first four disciples. The way I see people transform today sure doesn't happen this quickly. Jesus just says, "Follow me," and immediately they left their nets and followed him. Now, maybe it happened that way. I don't want to say it didn't. But what I do want to say is that a true disciple will have that kind of readiness. I'd be more likely to think that this was maybe a process of some conversations over a few weeks. And Jesus said, "Hey, I'm into something. Do you want to be a part of it? Let's go." I hope we realize that we're called to discipleship the same way. We hope that the point comes when we are ready to let go of our nets. What are our nets? Our security systems. Fishing is Simon and Andrew's economic livelihood. And Jesus said to let go of it. He says, "I'm going to teach you how to fish in a new way, to fish for people." What he means is that he's going to give them a new vocation. What is God asking us to do? Where is God asking us to go? Those questions that Father Richard poses are often difficult to ponder because we like to hold on to the reins. We like to stay in control. And we often feel that if we lose our grasp on what was or is, we won't be able to harness what's ahead and keep it in line with our own desires and plans. But isn't that the point? We'd rather deal with what we are wanting to do. We want to go where we want to go. If we listen to God's asking in our doing and going, we may end up at places that just aren't what we had in mind. In a recent gathering of my PACT colleagues, pastors accompanying congregations in transition, one of my colleagues wondered whether we remember that the church is Jesus' church and not our own. Pastor Kristen Nielsen, our synod facilitator, reminded us that as great and mighty as the churches established by the Apostle Paul were, how many of them are still standing and active? None. Another person shared that we can still have hope because even though different congregations have come and gone from the time of Paul through the Reformation and all the other schisms and divisions, guess what? We're still here. Christianity still exists. Jesus is still and will be present with us and for us. The church, Christianity itself, may look a little bit different than it did in those early days, and it will continue to change with all the seasons of life. And so we can choose to plant seeds, to water them, and aid them in giving shelter for those who need it, food for those who are hungry, create means of continuous planting, rebirth, and harvest, or we can choose to let those seeds lie dormant in a packet or a jar on the shelf. We can choose to be sprinkled as yeast over the flour of our surroundings in order that ideas and ministries, the good news of Jesus Christ, the love of God grows and expands and abounds to bring about a change of seasons, of social change, justice change, creational change in our communities. Or we can sit lifeless in a packet or ajar on our shelves. We can choose to engage the challenge of going with the flow of the change of seasons in the church as they intersect with the change of seasons in our community and the world. Or we can choose to sit in 90-degree weather of social and spiritual climate with our mittens on because we choose to not make any adjustments. The church has faced many changes of seasons throughout its history, throughout its life cycle. Let us engage the seasons of change as we would the first buds of spring, the warmth of a summer rain, the magnificence of the changing colors of autumn, the excitement of a child for the first snow that promises an outing to the sledding hill. Let us open ourselves to the seasons of change as great opportunities, both as individuals, as congregations, as ELCA bodies in Kenosha, as the church at large, to listen to what God is asking us to do and to be, to where God is asking us to go. This is not our church, it's God's. May God's Holy Spirit give us the strength, guidance, and boldness to roll with God's change of seasons for us. Amen.
Please join us as we sing the hymn of the day, Great is Thy Faithfulness, 733. O God, our help. You walk with us through all of life's changes. Grant us strength, patience, wisdom, and understanding. O God, our hope. You come to us in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. Show us your salvation and lead us in the way of the cross. O God, our shelter. Enfold us like a mother hen gathering her chicks. Watch over all who are sick, grieving, lonely, and in need this day. O God, our home, you claim us as your beloved children. Lord, remember us when you come into your kingdom. All of this we ask through the one who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray the prayer our Father taught us together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Steadfast God, you bless us amid all of the changes and chances of life. Grant us servant hearts that we may feed the hungry and welcome the stranger. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The Lord of peace give you peace at all times and in all ways. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
So our Sunday song is different than in the bulletin. It's 774, What a Fellowship, What a Love, a Joy Divine.
Go now in peace, for nothing can separate you from the love of God in Jesus Christ. Thanks be to God.